So if you have your Bibles, go to Daniel chapter 3, and we're going to start there with a story. Let me tell you a little bit about, before I read the verse, I want to give you a little bit of background on the verse today. If you would just say with me, say, my heart's open, my mind's ready, I'm here, all here, glad I'm here. I'll never be the same again. The Word of God is changing me, line on line, here a little, there a little. And today is another day of progress. Say, I'm ready. Say, I'm open. Bring it on. All right, that's what I'll do. Bring it on. So there's a story in the book of Daniel about three friends who were serving the Lord in the idol-worshipping ancient Babylon. Their names were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These guys were not troublemakers. They were very involved in their city and in their communities. In fact, they were called province leaders. So they were involved and investing themselves in other people and, you know, just community-oriented guys in the city there, Babylon. But they believed in the God that we believe in as Christians. And the Babylon, where they were and their families had been brought to be, you know, into captivity, was an idol-worshipping nation. And so these guys were, you know, in the middle of all of that, continuing to be devoted to God. And then the law started being enforced that if you don't worship the images, the idols, and especially the golden image of the king that they had just built, then you would be found in noncompliance with the law, and you would be put to death, sentenced to death, in a fire furnace. Okay, so that's a little background on it, and Daniel chapter 3, verse 12 has led us up to that point, and it says, but there are some Jews, okay, so let me give you a little more. They got reported, okay, they got reported for noncompliance by some people that were aware of them, and so they're standing before the king, reporting to the king about these guys. It says, there's some Jews, king, whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no attention to you, your majesty. They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold that you have set up. So the first thing that I want to talk about out of this story is that not every friend is a friend in faith. Not every friend in your life is a friend in faith. In other words, there's some people who will be your friend as long as you comply to their lifestyle, as long as you do what they want you to do. But if you stand for what you believe in, those friends are going to talk about you behind your back. They're not going to like it because you go to church. They don't want you to be a believer or to be a Christ follower. And I want to just differentiate in your pool of friendships other friends from what I'm calling friends in faith. People who are not friends in faith are not on the same path that you're on. It doesn't make them bad people. It just means they're not friends in faith. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were friends in faith. They supported one another's convictions, one another's lifestyle, one another's decision to serve God. And every believer, if you're a believer hearing me today, let me just proclaim to you that every believer needs friends in faith. Every believer needs people who share your belief in God. People who support your faith in God. Every believer needs friends who will encourage you to stand when it's not easy to stand. Encourage you to be strong in faith when it's not easy to be strong in faith. And you might be hearing me this weekend, and you might would say, well, okay, but what if I don't have friends like that? Then I would say back to you, it's time to find some friends like that. That's what this message is about. To proclaim that it's time to start friending people of faith. Consistently, continually. If you're a man and you don't have some solid man friends of faith, it's time to start friending. If you're a stay-at-home mom whose friends don't attend church, it's time to start friending some people who do go to church. Some moms who are on the same page raising children who believe in God and want God's will for their children. It's time to start friending. Some people that are hearing me today, when I start talking like this, you're introverted. And I want to just tell you that by nature, I'm shy. That may shock you. Honestly, it's the truth. I'm shy. I'm more introverted. My wife is absolutely not. And we make a good team. But I'm shy. I understand is the point. I understand how you can be and feel more reserved. You might would even say, well, hey, I don't talk to them because they don't talk to me. Like, I'm not going to walk across the room. Why can't they walk across the room to meet me? Like, I'm not going to stop at the red tent or the black tent. I'm good. I don't need no. You might be that person that I'm talking to today. Or you might be the person who would say, hey, I got my friends. In other words, you got your two, you got your three, you got the ones you're kind of connected to, hanging out with, and like, that's it. Like, you started drawing the line. And by the way, this is a big deal in our culture today. There's a popular song out called No New Friends, and it's a pop song. Young adults are gonna know what I'm talking about today. And the song, it's not a good song. It's got a lot of vulgarity in it. But, is that a word, vulgarity? I think it is, yeah. It's vulgar. And the song is really popular, but it's about, you know, me and my tight little group don't need no new friends. We're just us, like, we the ones. Like, I'm up here like a rapper, like, trying to rap. We're the one, like me and you, you my homeboy. We're like, you got it all together. Like. But can I just tell you that if you're alive and you're breathing today, God's not finished sending friends into your life. And He's not finished using you to be a friend to people that come into your life. If you're a young adult today, and your friends are not like friends in faith, it's time for you to start friending. Like, can I be any more blunt? Like, than just coming right out today and saying, it's time for you to come out of a comfort zone. It's time for you to realize that your friendships are a huge part of what God will do and wants to do in your life. Like, friends is not just something that doesn't matter. Friends matter in a huge, big way. And the friends that God has for you won't come into your life unless you start friending them. Think about that for a minute. Some people have a, like, it's like at the hotels, there's on the door knob, you can put that sign up, says do not disturb. There's some people that have that on their face all the time. They come to church and they like, do not disturb, do not disturb, do not disturb. You think people are going to knock on the door? You think people are going to bang on the door? The people that God is bringing into your life won't really come into your life unless you start friending them. They're not going to come looking for you, hanging out with your negative, opinionated party friends, at least not for long. It starts with you. The Bible says in Proverbs 18 and 24, a man who has friends must himself be friendly. A man who has friends must himself be friendly. So whether you're an introvert, whether you're an extrovert, whether you come from a big family, whether you got 3 friends, 5 friends, or 30 friends, a man who has friends must himself be what? Be friendly. When Sheila and I, thank you, by the way, for celebrating all year with us, 30 years of ministry. We've had fun. And today's, this weekend's greeting, again, from a pastor friend. It's just awesome. And the appreciation and respect, thank you so much for all of that. But when we were about 2 years in, year and a half in, 2 years in, our church started to grow a little bit. And I don't know, there might have been about 500 people there or so. I don't know. But we were over in Puyallup, okay? It's still funny to me that God brought us both out of big cities in the Midwest, and we came to Puyallup, which felt like a foreign mission field. Like, where? Puyallup. Like, yeah. And God was good, and God was doing great things, and we knew we were supposed to be here, but one of the things that it bothered me was that our church, as it was growing, it was all white people, Caucasian people. And her and I, and even with our leader friends, we would talk and say, man, we want to have a church of color. Like, we don't like that we're a white church. And some people were like, well, hey, you're in Puyallup. Like, what do you expect, you know? But there was one African-American lady who came with some friends, a bit older lady, and she was awesome, but that was it. And so one day, this family came in, this couple came in. They were sitting about halfway back in the middle section. I still remember it like it was yesterday. And they were African Americans, and as soon as I got done preaching and speaking that day, I jumped off the platform and I went back. I said, excuse me, made my way to where they were, kind of in the middle section, and I'm like, I'm so glad to see you here. Thank you for coming today. I sure hope you like it. I hope you come back. And honestly, like, I was like blunt. I was like, at the risk of being misunderstood, I just realized that it could be very uncomfortable for them to be there and, you know, the first time and look around and no one looks like them. And so I just said to them, I've been praying for you to show up. I was like really, I was like right out there. And I didn't know him, honestly. This is a true story. I didn't know him, but I'm like, I'm so glad you're here. Thank you for coming. Thank you for showing up. And I hope you'll come back. I'm sure you noticed, like we're all white. But we don't want to be all white. And don't listen to nobody else but me. Like, don't listen to don't let any other vibes bother you. Like, I've been praying for you to show up, and now that you're here, like, don't leave. Like, can you help me start from here? The vision God put in my heart, because what I see in my heart is not all white. Now, what I'm trying to say to you is that, well, let me tell you a little bit more about it. Like, it didn't, not only did they come back, he became my personal assistant. And up until, he was already retiring from the military at that point, and so then up until his second retirement, he became my personal assistant, which is about as close to me in my life as you can get. He served in other capacities in the church, and I love this man so much. His wife, Catherine, Russell's his name, and they were such a godsend for me, and I think I was for them. And together we became not only co-workers, but great friends. And it wasn't just that, you know, something new and fresh came into our church by the will of God in terms of diversity, but it was also that I'm white. I've never been black. He's black. He's never been white. He was in the military. I'm a pastor. I don't know what it's like to be a soldier. I know what it's like to be a pastor. Soldiers don't know what it's like to be a pastor. They only know what it's like to be a soldier. A black man doesn't know what it's like to be a white man. A white man doesn't know what it's... And we were close enough that there was nothing off limits. We had amazingly blunt and honest friendship conversations. He helped me so much. I'm still not perfect in this, but he helped me. Like, I asked for it. I threw the door open. Some of you are really tense right now because of all the stuff going on in our nation. You know, it's just crazy what's going on and all that's happening in our nation today. Whether, you know, whatever side of the fence you're on in terms of law enforcement or African-American or white or something in between or none of the above. It's just mind-boggling, the strife and all the crazy things that are happening. But here's the deal. That friendship for me was a godsend. It was... Because I would say to him, like, so, like, how'd I do today? And he'd go, that was awful. Like, and I'm talking about when I would touch on racial talk or something like that. He said, that was not good. Like, let's change that before the next service. I'm like, okay, well, how do I say that? Like, and he'd say, well, here's how you say it. Like, for someone in my world, here's how you need to change that. Like, you need to say that. Well, that's not fair, Russell. They're judging me. If I can't talk like that, he said, no, Pastor. Remember, like, we're in this together. I'm helping you, you're helping me, and we just had that kind of awe. And God did some great things for me, with me. It was kind of like a Jonathan David sort of thing, in that God used him to help me and to help build this church. That, as you can see today, whether you're in Bellevue or whether you're in Tacoma, is a diverse church where people love each other and care about each other. Come on, and there's a lot of grace for one another. What I'm telling you is that God has people in your life that are not going to come into your life unless you're friendly, unless you come off the platform and make your way to where they are and open up your heart, you won't become the person God wants you to be, and they won't be the person God wants them to be, because you're not following with an open spirit toward friendships that God and people that God is putting in your life. And you're like, well, me and God, we got our own thing going. Can I just tell you, shut up, first of all. But can I tell you that when God gets ready to work in your life, you know what he'll do? He will use other people. He will use people different than you. Come on, and he will make us better together. Somebody shout, better together. Yeah. Say it again, better together. Yeah. My wife and I are absolutely not alike. Yeah. But we are better together. And every time you look at personal growth, there'll be a person attached to it. Every time, if you're praying for something, can I just tell you that God will answer your prayer through other people? God works through people. He works through relationships in our life. And so hear me when I tell you today that the enemy wants to keep you where you are right now, with the friends you have right now. And as long as he can keep you in your comfortable relationships, he can hold you back from the destiny that God has for you. Did you catch that? The enemy is working to keep you comfortable being distant, being aloof, being isolated. The day you start opening up and looking around you, whether again you have no friends in faith or a few friends in faith, stay open, because God's adding more relationships into all of our life. And show me your friends, and I will show you your future. Show me your friends. I just caught some of you. I caught your attention now. Because up until now, you thought this was just a nice little friendship message. Show me your friends. Show me your friends. I'll show you your future. Don't underestimate the influence that your friends are having on you, for bad or for good. For bad or for good. I look back and there's many Russells in my life. There's many people who I could look at and I can tell you they added, I am better because of those people in my life. Your friendships are a force forming your future. You probably saw earlier, notice, let me just take you back to the video with our two student leaders on the video side by side today. And they're talking about a new thing that we're doing with our junior high age at our church, and how we're bringing all young people together on Wednesday nights with a different sort of event-oriented sort of thing. There's a lot of relational opportunity. And then on the weekend, they're going to be serving in different parts. They're going to be interacting. They're going to be in the auditorium. We're going to have places where they can sit together. But behind some of that is the thought and the prayer of just recognizing the power of the relationships in our kids' lives and how impacting the friendships they have at school and in the neighborhood are actually having on them. So our student leaders told me this. They said, even since school started, you can see a difference in our young people. They were coming to church with one attitude. Now they walk in and we're like, who is this person? Many of them are very different than they were a couple of months ago, coming to church. Their worship, they're not engaging like they were. They're distant, they're aloof, and show me your friends, and I'll show you your future. And it's not like we don't have anything to do here as a staff. It's not like we don't think that you're busy as parents. We just know that we have a challenge today. We know the influence that friendships have on young people. And we want to surround them with our teams, our leaders. We want to create a place and a space for kids who want to love Jesus and serve Jesus to be together consistently on an ongoing basis. Because we know that the enemy is setting a lot of young people up to be in the wrong relationships. We want to do everything. Come on, Champion Center. Come on, Mom and Dad. We want to do everything within our power. And so I hope that you parents will do your part consistently, bringing your children of all ages every week to services and events that we do. Do everything to get them mixing and mingling and involved. Help us break down the walls. Help us connect your kids to the life of the church and other kids whose parents want the same thing that you want. Some of you are like, well, they don't want to go to church, or they come to church, they want to stay by me, they don't want to go be with the kids, they don't want to do that. And you're just like, and I'm like, I hear that, and I'm like, well, they don't really want to go to school either. You're the parent. Be smart. Be smart. And actually, some parents sometimes get in the way. We literally have young people that we're reaching for, and mom steps in. Stop it. Stop it. We're here to be partners for the future of your children. And your children need to be in atmospheres where they can find friends in faith. They need more than mommy. They need friends in faith. You know those two young men that you saw on the screen? They're now our student leaders and pastors. You know those two that I showed you that grew up here? They grew up in the house of God. Friends in faith. My grandson, Kyan, he's 6 years old right now. And a couple of years ago, I noticed that his cousin, whose name is Drew, he's a little bit older than Kyan. He's probably 4 or 5 years older. And I noticed how Kyan just looked up to him, admired him. Like, hey, Kyan, come over here. He looks at me, looks at Drew. I'm going with Drew. Like, you know, it's like, Drew. So one day I pulled Drew aside. I said, Drew, first of all, it could be overwhelming for a 10-year-old, right? He's standing in front of me. I said, Drew, Kyan thinks you hung the moon. Like, my grandson, Kyan, he does what you do. Like, if you go to class, he goes to class. Like, if you worship, he worships. Don't mess it up. Man to man. Don't mess it up. Be an example, will you? Like, always know that he is being influenced by what you do. And Drew took me up on it. Like, we high-fived, and he's come through big time. He has been a huge part of helping my grandson go to classes, raise his hands, but you got to fight for it, is what I'm saying. Come on, you got to be smart about this. You can't just go with whatever comes your way. You got to fight for the right relationships, not only in your life, but in the life of your children. They will be influenced by someone, somewhere. Do everything you can. Come on, together we can raise some champion children at Champion Center. The Bible says, walk with the wise and become wise. A companion of fools suffers harm. See, everyone who's good to you is not good for you. And they don't have to be bad people to not be good for you. Because some of you are like, well, what's wrong with that? Hear me out a minute. Some people are in codependent relationships. Neither of them are actually bad people. It's just that they support the weakness in each other. Like if you really dug into why, what brings them together is their weakness, not their strength. It's an attitude that's funky that actually they relate to in one another. The dysfunction or the weakness or the whatever it might be. I heard the story of a gal who told how she was dating a guy, and that guy was unhealthy and ate all the wrong things, and his lifestyle was unhealthy, and she just kind of like became very much that way. And then that relationship broke off, and she started dating another guy who was into fitness and health, and she just, her observation of that was that I started being affected in a positive way by that, and fitness and health, and that's really what I wanted all along, but she just observed herself in two different relationships. And that's what I'm talking about. Some people in your world, they're not bad people, but what you're relating to in them is your own weakness in them. And like you get talking and that's what kind of comes out. And your attitude or your thought or your mindset, you get people together who don't like work, don't want to go to work. That's what they talk about. Oh, it's Monday again. Oh, it's Monday. Like, I can't believe it. Yeah, my boss is and my boss is that. And it's the weakness. You get two wives together who don't, they're unhappy with their husband. They think that they're being treated unfairly. You get them talking, and it just drills down deeper into what they're not happy about, what they're not content, their attitude. But you take that gal and you put her with another good friend, when she shares what she's going through, the good friend would not accompany her in the weakness, but would say, hey, let's pray for that to change. Let's believe that God can do something to turn that around. As iron sharpens iron, Proverbs 27 says, so a friend sharpens a friend. Isn't that good? A friend sharpens a friend. So let me go back to our text today. Where we left off in the book of Daniel was that these three friends were reported for noncompliance, and they had refused to bow to the idol of the king. And even, you know, after being brought before the king once and being warned and told, don't do that again, you got to bow when the horn sound, they're like, well. And he's like, you're going to be sentenced to die. Bow, bow, bow. I don't know where these guys met. I don't know how long they knew each other. I don't know if they grew up together. I don't know. But one thing is evident is that they supported one another's strengths. They were together in faith. They were friends in faith. I don't know how they encouraged or what they said or how they went about it, but it's obvious they were three for three. Like, there wasn't one that said, I can't handle it. No, no. They were supporting, and it was three for three. Under the pressure, it was three for three. So verse 16 says that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, Nebuchadnezzar, and said, we don't need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the furnace, our God is able to deliver us And he would deliver us. But even if he doesn't, I love that. That's a whole message right there. Even if he doesn't, Your Majesty, we're not going to serve your gods. And we're not going to worship the image of gold that you've set up. And then Nebuchadnezzar became furious. Guys, this is a real story. This is real human beings. These are three men facing a fire furnace. It's not just. It wasn't fair. But together, they were better. He got so angry, he just lashed out, the king did, and he said, heat the furnace 7 times hotter than usual. And then he commanded some soldiers, the strongest soldiers, the Bible says, in his army to tie them up, throw them into the blazing furnace. And so these men, wearing their robes and their trousers and their turbans and other clothes, were bound and they were thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent, the Bible says, and the furnace was so hot that the flames of fire killed the soldiers who took them and threw them in. And these three men, firmly tied, fell in to the blazing furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet. So he's watching from above. He has a kind of aerial view. And he stands to his feet, the Bible says, in amazement. And he starts asking the people around him. He says, how many did we put in there? Like, how many, help me out. Like, he's looking, there was three, right? Three? Four. Not three. And the Bible says that he said, look, there's four. Not three, but four. Walking around unharmed. The fourth one looks like a son of the gods. Hear me out. Hear me out. Just one more little thing I want to say today. What's great about having friends in faith is that friends in faith are friends in fire. Friends in faith. Think about what I'm saying to you, is that if you have friends in faith, then they're friends in faith even in the fire, even when facing the fire. We have some friends who went through a major marriage crisis. They were a hot mess, honestly. But they were our friends in faith. And to their credit, they were invested in their friendships with people of faith. And at a time where you would say there's no way that this marriage is going to make it, I watched the friendships that they had developed provide unbelievable support to bring healing and to bring hope and to bring restoration into their life. Faith and fire. Faith and fire. Faith and fire. You don't always know where it'll come from, but just know that if you develop friends in faith, there will be friends that'll be with you in the fire. And not only will the friends be with you, but God's blessing and God's strength. And when they agree together, your friends come together in prayer. Come on. God will work miracles in your life. God will deliver you. God will come through for you. God will sustain you. God will strengthen you.